You know, for us at the library, another reason why tonight is so special is it's another one of those great events in which we're partnering with the University of Calgary. And specifically tonight, we've done all sorts of other programs with the School of Education and with the Hotchkiss Brain Institute. But tonight, Mr. Hill is here by the good graces of the University of Calgary and the Office of Diversity, Equity, and Protected Disclosure. So let's give them a round of applause. You know, in many ways, the library reflects and needs to reflect the diversity in our community and be a welcoming place and a point of entry for people who are new to the country, new to this community. And it's one of the roles that we embrace, we cherish, we relish. And we also would like to acknowledge a generous gift from RBC to the library to enable us to continue that focus and make sure that people who are new to this community, including many people from Syria, by the way, and the library is very, very proud to be a national and international leader in welcoming those folks who have left a very distressed area to find comfort and solace and at least safety here in Calgary. If not, it's a little cooler here maybe in some ways. So now I'm going to turn the stage or the microphone over to Cheryl Fogo, a playwright, author, and journalist, well known to all of us here in Calgary. I keep running into her at all sorts of events, and she's going to introduce Lawrence Hill. So Cheryl, would you please come up?
Thank you. Hello, everybody. The first time I encountered the work of Lawrence Hill was through Blackberry Sweet Juice on Being Black and White in Canada. This raw, honest book alerted me that I had discovered a literary spirit who was not afraid to speak his truth, and through doing so, was speaking truth for millions of Canadians whose voices had not been heard. Since that time, he has gone on to create some of my favorite literary and cinematic works, including Seeking Salvation, a documentary film about the Black Church in Canada, both his multi-award-winning book, The Book of Negroes, and the multi-Canadian Screen Award-winning miniseries of the same name, and his current bestseller and recent winner of Canada Reads, The Illegal. Lawrence has been breaking ground with his writing for decades. His work is bold and multi-layered, and his research is impeccable, something that's important to me because I'm a historian as well. He is the author of 10 books and has written more pieces of journalism than could possibly be listed here. The quality of his work can be attested to by wide readership, multiple honors, the longevity of his career, and by unique distinctions such as the fact that he is the only writer to have won Canada Reads twice. Alongside its quality, however, the importance, there's that pop we were talking about, the importance of his work cannot be overstated. He rescues us from the mistake we have made so often as Canadians of distorting our vision of who we are by erasing our own histories. He offers unflinching portrayals paired with difficult themes in a time when honest, fully inclusive conversation is more important than it has ever been. With intelligence and compassion and really, really entertaining writing, he provides necessary explorations of the challenges of living in a pluralistic society. In addition to everything he achieves in the literary realm while living in Hamilton and Woody Point, Newfoundland with his lovely family, Lawrence Hill volunteers extensively with organizations that have supported women and children in several African nations and incarcerated men in Canada, to name just two of his many, many volunteer commitments. He is also a generous mentor. I had the opportunity just days ago to spend a week along with 7 other Canadian writers under his tutelage at the Banff Centre, and it will stand as one of the best literary experiences of my own writing career. And it is the place where he finally persuaded me, after many years of knowing him, to call him Larry. He was born into a gifted and accomplished family. Last night, my husband and I attended a concert by another of the famous Hills. Lawrence's brother Dan was here, performing as part of a fundraiser for Jewish Family Services Calgary. And what a warm and powerfully moving evening it was. It was so wonderful to see Lawrence there in the audience, supporting his brother, who's only recently resuming his musical career after recovering from cancer. Lawrence helped to bring his late sister Karen Hill's book, Cafe Babanusa, a book I've just started reading, and which is wonderful so far. And he wrote a touching foreword to accompany that book. Upcoming, he will be chairing the 2016 Giller Prize Jury and teaching at the University of Guelph in September. He will be adapting The Illegal as an 8-part miniseries, and yay, he's working on a new novel. I've talked about his past, I've talked about his future, but aren't we so lucky that right here and now, in this very moment, he's with us to share this beautiful day in Calgary. Please welcome Lawrence Hill.
Thank you. Thank you so much, Cheryl. That was such a beautiful, touching welcome. I really appreciate that. I can't think of a person I'm more honored to be introduced to, honored to be introduced by than Cheryl Fogel. We share so many interests. We share so many writerly and historical interests. And Cheryl has done such a fabulous job of dramatizing and writing in all sorts of ways about the West, the Canadian West, the Black West, the migration of African Americans into the West in the early 20th century. These are stories that still bear many signs of being buried and still mourned. Fantastic and energetic, dramatic exploration. So thank you so much, Cheryl. And of course, talking about families, just today, Cheryl's husband, Clem Martini, welcomed me to meet his students and those of Larissa Lai at the University of Calgary, and that was a wonderful session. We spoke about the challenges of adapting fiction to screen and what that was like, and that was a fun, informal sort of chat session with a handful of students. And on that note, I want to thank the University of Calgary and the Calgary Public Library for sort of teaming up to bring me to do two events here in the city today. It was great. And it was particularly touching to come in time to listen to my brother sing last night in a little theater in Kensington. That was really great. So thank you. It's very, very wonderful to be back here. And since we're in the library, I should say that, as many of you probably know, I've been welcomed many times to Calgary before and many times by the Calgary Library. It's wonderful to be back again, and it brings back memories that I was mentioning to a smaller group of people just here a few minutes ago about my first times in libraries. Well, I had the great luck to have two parents who loved to engage us with literature. My father told us stories. I don't think my father ever read a story to us, but he just made up great stories at the bedside when I was a child, and we'd look so much forward to him making up stories. And my mother read to us nightly, and of course, it's one of the greatest gifts you can give to a child, whether it's in your, the child's in your family or not, it doesn't matter. It's reading to children is such a fantastic thing to do, and she loved to read us nonsense poetry, and what a great way to sort of incite a riotous enjoyment of language than to read nonsense poetry to children. The playfulness of language just shoots out, and certainly infected me with a love of language and play on the page and orally as well. I'm reminded of a great book by Alan Bennett, the British writer, called The Uncommon Reader. And it's a novella. It came out the same year as The Book of Negroes in 2007, and you could read it in an hour. It's a lovely, entertaining romp of a book. And The Uncommon Reader is about the Queen, who one day falls by mistake into a bookmobile passing by the Royal Palace. And she suddenly is overtaken by this insane and thoroughly unjustifiable desire to read. And suddenly the queen becomes an inveterate reader, and it totally messes up her queenly duties. So it's a spoof of a novel, a hilarious satire about all the terrible things that happen to a queen who's suddenly afflicted with the joy of reading by dint of having fallen into a bookmobile. So it's quite a funny book and a delightful read, and I'd recommend it to you, especially since I'm speaking in a library, the Calgary Library. The first book that I started borrowing from the Don Mills Public Library in Toronto was were the Beverly Cleary books, Henry Huggins, which I just so loved, and I just couldn't wait to finish one and run back and get another from the library. So I have very fond memories of libraries, and it seems like I've spent my my life in them, researching books and reading others. I'll speak a little bit about The Illegal and then give a short reading from it and then talk briefly about my late sister's life and work, Karen Hill, and her novel Cafe Babinosa, and then open it up to questions. When I was 16, I had my first summer job working in the Toronto airport. It was 1973, and I worked for the Ontario Welcome House, an agency of the Ontario government. And my job as a 16-year-old, working from 9 to 5, Monday to Friday, in the summer at the airport, was to welcome landed immigrants to Canada, help them find their suitcase, help them get up the escalators, help them make their way through customs and immigration with their papers, and often guide them to accommodation, as many didn't have a place to stay for the first few weeks, so I'd had a list of 25 cheap motels and hotels where I could send people and set them up until they had a better place to stay. So that was basically my summer job, welcoming immigrants and showing them a friendly face as they arrived in the airport at Toronto. And it was 73, which was a very heady year for me to have such a job, because it was 1 year after 72. And in 1972, the absolutely murderous despot Idi Amin expelled Ugandan Asians from Uganda. And if you happen to be Asian living in Uganda, no matter how many generations and decades you or your family had been there, you were out. And you had to get out or you'd be killed. And so suddenly Ugandan Asians were forced to leave Uganda in East Africa. And it was one of our better moments in Canadian history. We welcomed many of those refugees to Canada. And although they were kicked out by Idi Amin in 72, many came by circuitous routes to Canada, and many were still arriving in 73, the year I worked in the airport, and everybody going by bus from the suburbs of Don Mills to the airport. I'd see in the airport, waiting for hours, Ugandan Asian refugees. Politics in a really visceral way, and it excited me about the plight of migrants and made me imagine more deeply what it meant to be dislocated and have to move around the world because an evil murderer had required you to leave. And thinking about what it meant to be a refugee, and then about them. 10 years later, I started visiting West Berlin to see my sister, with whom I was very close, Karen Hill. She lived in West Berlin for a decade or so, up to a year or so before I came down. And she was in love with a man who'd come through the Berlin Wall and landed in West Berlin and with no real papers or ability to carry on a life that was kind of legally sanctioned by the West German authorities. In watching Seth, my sister's husband, and his fellow countrymen from Sudan cope and live without legal license in a place that's so regimented as West Germany made me think more about what it would mean to be not just a refugee, but a stateless person with no place to call home and no passport and no formal documentation. And of course, in Canada, as in the United States and in other countries, there are a great many undocumented people living without legal license, living under the radar screen, and I ended up writing a novel about that very idea. What would it mean to be living without legal license in a place that doesn't want you? So Freedom State becomes a country to which my character Keita Ali, a 24-year-old elite marathoner from the fictional island of Zantarland. It becomes a country to which he flees as he's leaving genocide behind. And so I think I'll read you a few excerpts from The Illegal to give you a sense of the movement and the story of Keita Ali, this 24-year-old elite marathoner who flees genocide in the fictional Zantarland and comes to hide in a country that doesn't want him, one of the richest nations of the world, called Freedom State. Since Keita is an elite marathoner, I thought I'd open the novel in the middle of a marathon. "Go home." The words came from the runner on Keita's left, white and surely from Freedom State, limp brown hair flopping as he ran, arms too high, choppy gait. Running was the smoothest dance in the world. Keita was trained to picture his own legs like wheels. He'd learned to strike with his feet soundlessly, transfer weight through the balls of his feet, roll off the toes and spend more time flying than earthbound. Anybody could run, but few with grace. This competitor ran as if his tires weren't inflated. The runner on his shoulder said it again, "Go home." A rude man, he deserved to suffer. Keita bumped up the pace. Sooner or later, the obnoxious fellow would start to hurt. The name of the game was to inflict more pain than he felt. So Keita, a stranger in a strange land whose only transgression was to exist in a place where his presence was illegal, would use speed to break this man. Keita had studied a map of the Buttersby Marathon. It was an out-and-back route, 21.1 kilometers east along the Chelting Escarpment, a 180-degree turn, and 21.1 kilometers right back to the finish line. A few kilometers after the halfway turn, they would climb up the mountain's one and only hill. It would curve, steepen, and keep rising for 2 kilometers. Challenging, for sure. But what were 2 kilometers uphill at sea level in Freedom State compared to the red hills of Zantarland at altitude? They ran along a winding road bordered by the tallest pine trees Keita had seen. Here along the marathon route, branchless trunks reached many stories into the air and exploded into a riot of needles and cones. Keita inhaled the smell of pine. Odd to find such welcoming trees in this hostile land. Driving just ahead of them were 3 police motorcycles. One carried a race official who sat facing backward to keep his eye on the leading marathoners. Keita tried to put the police officers out of his mind. They'd never suspect him, not in a race, not under their noses. The motorcade rounded a corner, and the instant it slipped out of sight, the fellow to Keita's left threw a low punch. Keita saw the blow coming and stepped to the right, but it glanced off his umbilical hernia. The hernia, now the size of a golf ball, throbbed. Could the other runner tell it was there under Keita's shirt? The runners rounded the corner, and the motorcycles came into sight again. It wouldn't be enough to beat his aggressor. Keita wanted to make him suffer. But the runner remained close. "Gonna mess you up," the man said. Keita drifted to the far side of the road. The runner stayed with him. Keita swerved back. The name collar stuck to him. A string of orange cones marked the halfway point. The runners rounded the turn and began to run back in the direction from which they'd come. Keita glanced up at the large digital clock, which showed 1 hour, 5 minutes, 11 seconds. Keita's adversary tucked in behind him, and a third runner trailed by a step, another white guy from Freedom State. 200 meters back in the direction of the finish line, they blew past the 4th and 5th place runners. 600 meters further along, they encountered another trickle of outbound runners. The jerk remained 1 stride back. At the base of the hill, they passed the 24-kilometer mark. Keita picked up the pace once more, drilling down to just under 3 minutes per kilometer. They were passing a river of runners, and some of them held out their hands to congratulate him. Keita high-fived one or two, just to pretend that he was feeling no pain. As the grade of the slope increased, Keita employed the trick that he'd been taught while training in the red hills of Zantarland. Want to shatter your opponent's confidence? just when he starts to hurt, you sing. So that's how the story opens. And I meant the novel to feel a bit like a marathon, to sort of pull a reader into a race that sort of continues from the first page to the end. And since Keita is fleeing genocide, and since I want the reader to sort of feel why he has an unequivocal need to stay hidden and unfound and not deported from the country that he's now hiding in Freedom State, I thought I'd take the reader back to his childhood in the early pages and give a sense of just why this man had to flee the country that he's fled. So I'll now read you just a short section from Zantoroland when Keita is living with his father, Yo-Yo, and they get a visit one day. One day, Keita was frying eggs and heating beans for dinner, while his father sat in the armchair and read the New York Times, when someone pounded on the front door. Yo-Yo stashed his newspaper under his chair while Keita answered the door. Three government officials in suits and ties stood on the porch. The one closest to Keita said, "Stand at attention for His Excellency, President for Life of the Republic of Zantoroland." A man in robe stepped up from behind them. The white cloth of the robe was of the highest quality cotton, bordered with intricate blue stitching. Lots of people came to the door to pay homage to his father, but it took effort not to stare at the president and show all the hatred that he felt. As far as Keita was concerned, the president was responsible for his mother's death, his father's torture, and the deaths and disappearances of countless others, leaving his victims naked and dead in public places. Keita had been taught at home and at school not to hate, only to forgive. But looking at the president now, he felt no forgiveness. "No woman at the house to greet me?" the president said. He gave a booming laugh. One of his aides murmured that Yo-Yo was a widower. "Well," the president said, "every father needs a faithful son to cook for him." The president entered and approached the stove. Because of the unreliable electricity, the alley home had a small two-burner stove hooked up to two propane gas tanks. When one tank ran out, the other could be activated. "Quaint and lovely," the president said, "just like the ways of people up in the hills." Keita and Yo-Yo stood at a respectful distance. They knew to be silent. "Eggs and beans," the president said. "Would Your Excellency like some?" Keita asked, speaking out of turn without explicit invitation. Was the only way he knew to convey his contempt. "I would accept eggs and beans another time," the president said, "but as they're ready now, please go ahead and eat. Yes, serve your father, son, and yourself. Be at ease." Keita removed two fried eggs and placed them with beans on his father's plate. His father slid into his chair at the table, his look saying, "Do not speak again unless you're asked a direct question." Keita served himself, brought two mugs of water to the table, and sat with his father. The president's three aides stood silently at the door, each with his left hand hanging down and his right pulling back a suit jacket and resting on a hip, exposing a revolver. "So, Mr. Ali, renowned journalist of Zantoroland, how are your eggs this evening?" "They're almost as excellent as you," Yo-Yo said. Keita admired his father's response. One was required to use the term "Your Excellency" in each phrase uttered to Jenkins Randall. This way, Yo-Yo came close without quite satisfying the president's dictates. "You must be proud of your son." The president stood behind Keita and rubbed the back of his head. Keita felt the big palm moving slowly, methodically. The president's square ring scratched his scalp. "Yes, I am, Your Excellency," Yo-Yo said. He took in the sight of the president with his son's head in his hands and said, "To what do we owe the honor of a visit from Your Excellency?" "A father who's such a famous intellectual," the president said, "with a son who's ranked what now in the national marathon rankings?" "Fifth," Keita said. The president removed his hand from Keita's head and placed it on his shoulder. "Fifth, that's correct," Keita said. "Not easy in a country known for its runners." Yo-Yo glared at Keita, who kept his mouth shut this time. Keita didn't want to show any respect where it was not deserved, but neither did he want to do something to cause his father harm. The president began walking back and forth behind Keita and Yo-Yo, clapping his hands once each time he paused behind Keita. "Don't you agree that your father will be pleased to see to have a peaceful retirement and to see his son move up in the national marathon rankings?" "Yes, Your Excellency," Keita said. He remembered what had happened in the last Olympic Games, when not one of the three Zantorlander marathoners made it onto the medal podium. It had shocked the nation, because on a good day, any one of them could have won the race handily. When they returned to Zantorland, all three marathoners were imprisoned. 2 weeks later, when they were released, each used a red cane and walked with a permanent limp. "And you, Mr. Ali, have had quite the illustrious career. The New York Times, The Atlantic, The Guardian, Le Monde." "I've slowed down in recent years, Your Excellency." "Slowing down is a good thing, Mr. Ali. Gives you time to enjoy life, to enjoy your children." "Most thoroughly, Your Excellency," Yo-Yo answered. The president, a tall man with the girth of a boulder, stooped to speak in Yo-Yo's ear. "Do you follow boxing?" "A little, Your Excellency." "Would you agree that it pains the soul to see a boxer come out of retirement and enter the ring again?" "I never like to see anyone hurt, Your Excellency." "Precisely my thoughts. The wise boxer knows when to fight and when it's time to quit. It's all about balance and what seems right, Your Excellency." "I have just the proposition for you, Mr. Ali," the president said. "You are the perfect person to write my authorized biography and place it with publishers around the world." "I'll give that careful thought, Your Excellency," Yo-Yo said. "This project could bring pride to the people of Zantorland. You'd be richly compensated." "Due consideration, Your Excellency." The president stood still behind Keita. He let a moment pass. "Consider the comforts of a bigger home, a cook, an endless supply of good food for your family. It's a well-understood fact that journalists nearly take vows of poverty. How could a widower with children resist the miracle of the loaves and the fishes?" "There are the loaves and the fishes to consider, Your Excellency," Yo-Yo said. "But there's also the eye of the needle." The president stood absolutely still. Keita could hear him swallow. "Well, in my humble role as a servant to the people of Zantorland, I'll not endeavor to rush you to your good senses. Enjoy your eggs, Mr. Ali. And Mr. Ali Jr., I wish you fleet feet and a minimum of cardiovascular suffering. I'm sure that no father wishes to see his son in pain." The president left with his aides. A little while later, Zantorland erupts into full-fledged genocide, and Keita has to flee. And this final scene I'll read to you takes place in Freedom State when he's now hiding as a refugee, unwanted, in a country that's elected a government explicitly devoted to catching and deporting every refugee it can find. Keita is stifled in his emotional range. He's witnessed the most heinous murders, and he's managed just barely to get out with his own life. And he doesn't have a lot of joy or animation in his demeanor, and I wanted to keep him that way, dignified, hardworking, but emotionally in shock in this new land. We're really just in the first months of his time in Freedom State in this novel. And so to compensate for having a protagonist who's quiet as opposed to dynamic and colorful, I decided to have a cast of very lively, dramatic secondary characters whose light would bounce off Keita and thus make him interesting as they interacted with him. And one of the people that he comes to know is a character that I sort of drew really for the first time from my own 88-year-old mother. This is woman's name is Ivernia Beach. She's 85 years old in this novel. She's a widower. She's well-to-do, but has a host of problems. White, lives and was born in Freedom State, and one day she and Keita meet. Ivernia drew a long breath. Some 20 years ago, when she was in her 60s and still had nimble fingers, she'd taken up the classical guitar. If you played an instrument, something new, something you'd never touched before, it was said to prevent your brain from rotting. The guitar instructor introduced her to the music of Fernando Sor and encouraged Ivernia to breathe while she played. She told him that she'd come to study music, not yoga. She'd had to abandon the instrument after it gave her a tennis elbow. And now, as she ran once more through the events leading up to the accident, she exhaled slowly, just as a guitar teacher had taught her, and replayed in her mind a single moment of kindness and light in an otherwise all-around shitty day. Ivernia had been driving south on Aberdeen Road. She'd already passed Main Street and Queen Street. Now she was entering the thick of the village, the attractive section of Clarkson, lined with cafes, shops, beauty salons, and bookstores. Four blocks ahead were the Parliament buildings on the left and the Freedom Building with offices for federal politicians on the right. Beyond them was the giant Ruddings Park, and beyond that, the railway tracks, the formal end of the city. And after 5 kilometers of no man's land, the sudden mushrooming of Afric Town. But Ivernia wasn't going anywhere near that far. The Lox and Bagel was located right here in the heart of the village, and all Ivernia had to do was find a parking spot. She was driving her late husband's 1999 Oldsmobile Intrigue. It was 19 years old and not a speck of rust. Oversized like a car fueled with steroids, but it worked like a charm. Southbound traffic kept Ivernia to 20 kilometers an hour. It was a warm spring day. She had the windows down. Above the sound of traffic, she heard a man singing. Good voice. He had a lilting foreign accent and he was singing a country song. She glanced to her left. Nothing. To her right. There he was. A young black man was running as fast as her car. What a joy it must be, Ivernia thought, to move one's body with that ease and speed. Like Ivernia, he was heading south on Aberdeen. She wondered why he was in the road, but then noticed that pedestrians clogged the sidewalk. He was in his mid-20s, as thin as a pencil. Strapped to his waistband was an iPod, and from it, white wires ran up to the buds in his ears. Clearly, he had no idea how loud he was singing the country hit that had become as familiar as the national anthem. I've been running for you, baby, running all the time, but you're running for another heart, and the heart you want ain't mine. Ivernia had turned off the radio 20 times in the last year just to avoid hearing another note of that song. But it sounded funny and somehow touching coming from this strange runner. Traffic slowed. He ran by her door. His head was bobbing to the music and his eyes were wide open. He caught her looking at him and smiled. She smiled too, and then pulled ahead as the lane before her opened up. It was odd that a man moving that fast could sing as he ran. She left them behind as she accelerated. Traffic moved quickly, and Ivernia caught 2 green lights. There, up ahead, just 1 block, was the Lox and Bagel. Parking on Aberdeen was murder. But there, just ahead of her, directly in front of the Lox and Bagel, a car pulled out. Ivernia slowed down. A space big enough for her Oldsmobile. No fire hydrant. No reason she couldn't park there. She detested parallel parking. But there was no option. She pulled up beside a Jaguar, put the Olds in the reverse, and checked the rearview mirror. Lots of pedestrian traffic on the sidewalk, but there was nothing between her and the BMW parked directly behind her. She backed halfway in, turning the wheel clockwise to ease into the spot and then counterclockwise to straighten it out. She stopped midway to make sure she was fine. The Olds was such a big car. Everything seemed okay. And then it happened. She was about to press down on the accelerator ever so gently to continue reversing when a baby cried, loudly. She meant to jam her foot on the brake, but instead mashed it down on the accelerator. The old shot back, and the next instant, Ivernia felt metal crumple and heard glass shatter. A woman began screaming. Ivernia couldn't see the woman or the baby. Had she hit them? She flipped the gear into drive, pushed on the accelerator again, and charged forward, catching and demolishing the back left end of the Jaguar. She put her car in park and turned off the ignition, and then opened the door to more screaming. Avernia got out of the car. A woman on the sidewalk stood next to a stroller. The baby was in her arms. "Did I hit you?" Avernia asked. "My car." "Are you hurt?" Avernia said. "No, but almost. I was this close," the woman said, holding her thumb and index finger apart, "when you smashed into my car, and here I was with my baby." The singing runner showed up. "Hello, ma'am," he said to the young mother. "May I help?" She looked grateful. The runner lifted the stroller back to the far side of the sidewalk. The woman had dropped the bag of groceries. He retrieved cans and bags, bending and straightening until he'd stored them all in the stroller. The runner then saw Avernia, looked straight at her. "Ma'am, are you all right?" "Yes, quite," she said, but she wasn't all right at all, and he could see it in her eyes. "Why don't you sit down?" he said. There was a bench at the edge of the sidewalk, in front of the Lox and Bagel. He led her to it, his fingertips resting on her shoulder. She tried to remember the last time that anyone had touched any part of her body in a kind, solicitous way. "Everything's going to be okay," he said. "Nobody's hurt, right?" She nodded. He straightened, went to her car door, pulled out her purse and keys, and returned with them. "Sit here. You'll need your things," he said. "Are you okay, ma'am? Breathe a little." Avernia stared at him with glassy eyes. The earbuds were strung over his shoulder. From them, she detected the tinny sound of country music. "I heard you singing back there," she said. He smiled. "I sing when I train," he said. She heard a siren. She looked up and saw the police vehicle two blocks away. He said, "God bless, must run, take care. Don't worry, everything will be okay." Once more, he touched her shoulder. Avernia felt the calm spread through her body. Nobody was hurt. What was the worst that could happen? "Wait," she said. "What's your name?" He hesitated, smiled once more, and said, "Roger Bannister." "Goodbye and good luck." He set off running again southbound on Aberdeen Road in the direction of Ruddings Park and Africktown. "Roger Bannister," she mumbled to herself. She knew that name. The British runner, the first one to break the 4-minute mile. He did it on May 6, 1954, 64 years ago. She remembered. She was 21 years old, and it was the day that she and Ernie married. She wished that she'd had time to tell that to the runner. A hand was on her shoulder, a firm hand. "Ma'am, ma'am, were you involved in that accident? Are you the owner of that Oldsmobile?" She looked into the eyes of a square-jawed police officer whose expression seemed to say, "You've gone and ruined my perfectly good day." Perhaps Avernia should have waited for a lawyer, or fought the charge, or sought to plea bargain. She knew all about those things, but she was an old woman, and she had no mind for subtlety. So she just looked at him and said, "It all comes down to one thing, officer. I screwed up. So can we get on with it?" It was a day later now, and her license was suspended, her car impounded, and she was feeling suffocated in the meeting room of the Office for Independent Living. She was bursting with impatience. She wanted out. Whatever they were going to do to her, she wanted it over. So here she was, telling her three inquisitors one more time that she realized the gravity of the situation but did not want a lawyer. "Could we just get this done?" she said, keeping her hands under the table so the three inquisitors could not see them shaking. When you reach the age of 85, hands were simply not to be trusted. Avernia tried to calm herself by thinking of the gentle face of the runner, the one who'd stopped to help everybody, herself included. The runner was the only person who'd said a kind word to her that entire day. Avernia hoped the runner was not a refugee and that he would not be caught and deported like the others. She focused on her breathing and on good thoughts. Fernando Sor, the runner, singing country music, marrying her husband on the same day that Roger Bannister ran the Miracle Mile in 3 minutes and 59 seconds. Ernie had been good to her. from their first day together to their last. Breathe, Avernia, breathe. Keep breathing and just answer their stupid questions. Thank you. Do you know what I'll do? I'll just change gears for a minute and talk for a minute or so about a novel by my late sister, just for a minute or two, and then leave that subject and answer your questions, if I may. Karen was my younger sister by a year and 3 days, and she died in an accident 2 years ago. She'd been trying to publish her book. She'd been working on a novel for 20 years, her first and only novel. Karen had been living with bipolar disorder since her early 20s, when it sort of careened into view and brought her crashing down during her young bohemian years living as a Canadian in West Berlin. And I went to see her in West Berlin for the first time when she did enter into her first very manic, psychotic episode, and she had to be hospitalized really to save her life, as she'd become a danger to herself in her utter and complete psychosis. Kind of came out of nowhere, this bipolar disorder, but it has also affected my mother for her whole life, who first developed her illness at the same age that my sister was, when Karen's came into view when she was about 24. And so Karen lived with bipolar disorder for the rest of her life. She had a very rich and playful life. She traveled throughout the world, and she lived for 10 years in Germany, and she spoke fluent German and French, and also handled herself quite well in Italian, Portuguese, and Spanish. She was a great gardener and a wonderful cook. She came back to Canada after 10 years in Berlin, pregnant and a single mother, and decided to come back to Canada to raise her child, who's now my 26-year-old niece, Malaika. And she couldn't work. You know, she tried several times, and every time she went to work, she worked in ESL, and she worked for the Toronto Board of Education and for the Canadian Race Relations Foundation. She had various jobs. She was very bright, you know, a university graduate, but every time she went to work, she'd become sort of overwhelmed by the petty little stresses of work, showing up on time, being late when the bus was late, office conflicts and politics. These things seemed to throw her off her game and would drive her into manic illness, to be followed, of course, by very severe depression. And she'd become not just manic, but psychotic and schizophrenic. And so she became very ill when she became ill. And then she'd fight for about 6 months to pull herself back together after hospitalization. It would take about 6 months to bring herself down to earth again and to be able to write and read again. And then she'd have a little window, a window of 6 months, 12 months, maybe 18 months, until she'd get sick again. It was incredibly difficult for her to write. I've written 10 books, and every one of them felt like pulling teeth. I don't know how Karen did it, living with bipolar disorder, because as you can well imagine, when you come out of a psych wing and you're being stabilized, you're on pretty heavy antipsychotics. And in antipsychotics, perhaps maybe necessary to stabilize you and keep you from being rehospitalized and just bring you back to something slow and steady. But they also sort of kill the creative spark. Can you imagine how hard it is to write on antipsychotics? They kind of slow down your brain and turn it into mush. And Karen just hated these drugs. And so she tried to wean herself off them, talk to a psychiatrist, get a lower dose, get down to a level where she felt her mind was starting to kick into gear again, and then she'd write. She must have taken 8 mentorships in the course of her life. I paid for a couple of them, as she was broke, as she lived in poverty because she couldn't work and was on welfare because of her psychiatric illness. She couldn't hold a job. And so I encouraged her to, and read her manuscripts many times, as just as she read mine when I was working on my books. And finally, she died in an accident a couple years ago, the same day that she was released from a long hospitalization in Sunnybrook Medical Hospital and in Toronto. And this book was out there waiting for a publisher, and she hadn't been able to find one. And so I just picked up the job and continued to look for a publisher. And it finally landed with my publisher, HarperCollins Canada, who very graciously offered to publish it posthumously. And it was quite a task to figure out how to edit a book posthumously. Karen had written many, many drafts, and it was circulating to publishers when she died. So clearly, it was unequivocally her wish to see it published. But she didn't have a chance to edit it with an editor pushing her. And we all need editors pushing her. So I sort of played a little bit of that role with Jennifer Lambert, the editor at HarperCollins, who steered the process. And basically kind of did a very gentle job, just fixed obvious errors, cut out a bit of fat, you know, things that weren't necessary, that were repetitive. But I didn't add a single word and didn't change anything, just to pull out a few things to move it along a little more quickly. So it was a very light edit, and I sort of decided that the best way to handle a posthumous manuscript was to leave it be and leave its infelicities intact, but let its raw kind of energy pulse and just not get in the way of the voice. And think of it not just as a novel, but as an archival document, a reflection of her mind and her creative space at the moment that she died. And so that's her novel, Cafe Babanosa. She also wrote an essay called On Being Crazy, which is appended to the back of the novel in the book, and it's a lengthy, 6,000 or 7,000 word first-person essay about living lifelong with mental illness, comparing treatments in Germany to treatments in Canada, and just describing what it was like to write as a writer with bipolarity. It's a really fascinating essay, and I encourage you to read it if you choose to pick up the book tonight. That's about all for now about Karen, but thank you for giving me the chance to talk to her, talk to you a little bit about her, since she's not here to do it herself. And thank you so much for listening to me talk about The Illegal. And if we have a few minutes, I'd be happy to try to answer a few of your questions. And I'll repeat them from the mic so everybody can hear them. If you have a question or comment, I'd be happy to step in. I guess I should mention that I'm happily adapting the Illegal to a television miniseries now. I just turned in the first episode of 8. And so that'll be a process keeping me busy over the next year or so, adapting The Illegal to a television miniseries. That's kind of fun. So that's what I'm up to these days.